Spoke, I will present the overview of the robotics, starting from the first of the robotics, which was in 1960. And then I will move across here, showing how the paradigm for control and only the closer the mechanism, the relative architecture that guide robots changing related to the different objectives that robotics add along the spine. This is the status of robotics, starting from the field, as I said, in 1960. Then, 10 years later, we have this work in industrial robotics. In 1980s, starting the development of robotics, which was based on service robotics. Then we had the a new interest in bio-inspiration and the first modern platform ones were built. And in the end, we have the, what we have now, the current challenge, which is to apply adaptive and predictive behavior for robotics, which allow to control different platforms, even if this platform, for example, are very complex like soft robots. In this talk, we won't focus on the, let's say, morphology on the mechanics of the robot, but it will mainly focus on the control part. Let's start from the birth. Asimov is considered the father of robots. He wrote this book which contains, I remember, 9 science fiction stories about robots. And he did this in 1915. And the birth of robotics is considered 10 years after when the first industrial robot was installed in a manufacturing plant of the General Motors in the New Jersey. So from, let's start, robotics has grown exponentially in the last 50 years in different fields. And also the robot control and repair techniques improved and are now a wide range that allows to control different kinds of robots. So, we say that the robot starts in a manufacturing environment. And why? Because the manufacturing environment is a structured environment. This means that everything is fixed. Robot does not need perception to control what happens in the environment, and everything is very known, like position of the object, manipulate, velocity are standardized, and it's the optimal environment for a robot, but this restricted human presence, and also professional users can work with this kind of robots. But what was really improved in the machine environment were the performances of this robot in terms of accuracy, reliability, speed, and robustness. The Puma 560 was one of the first robots that one of the first manipulators, which was also available in the universities. So I think that it's one of the, we can say it is the father of the robotics in that moment. It had a 6 degree of freedom, and which were controlled by 6 brush DC servo motor, and all of them were also provided with controllers. Just to have a brief look to the Puma kinematics, you see we have this 6 degree of freedom, 3 years in the roof, and then the roof. And here we have the delta temperature parameters, which is a standard for robotics in order to get to standardize the definition of kinematics for the type of the. What is the direct and the inverse kinematics? The direct kinematics, these are the three basic, let's say, concept for robotics, and mainly for the robotics that we are focusing now, because we will see that, for example, if you have a more complex platform, it won't be always simple to define what is the investment analysis. And we define the direct analysis, the function that can translate the image in one method inside the indicator and position on the position and the rotation of the indicator. And inverse kinematics, which is usually more difficult to compute, is able to provide a joint angle starting from the angle of the rotation. These are the really basic robot control in joint space. You see that it is in joint space because in comparison we have this in the is done after the inverse kinematics computation. This is the classic control loop in which you have the control, the actuator, and the other mechanism, and then the feedback which is provided to your sensor. For what concerns the robot control in the rotational space, you see that the inverse Jacobian in this case is after the comparison. This means after the computation of the error, which comes from the reference, difference between the reference, and the sensor value. Just the last thing about control, the icon mask. And this is the PID, which is, I think, the most famous control mechanism used in robotics. Composed of three parts. The first one is a proportional part, the second one is a derivative part, and the third one is an integrative part related to the pattern. So, but not only control work within time, but also a different platform. We started from the human in 2016, then we have the Dexter arm, which for example available in our laboratory, which have low size and transmission was done using the cables. And then we have one of the last robotic arm available now, which was the one arm, which has a very high speed, or the DRF battery arm, which you can see also the difference in the grip attached to the to this robotic arm. So we had an idea about the industrial robotics and the control applied in this, and we just showed a very basic one. But now we can move toward the surface robotics and the autonomous robotics. Well, service robotics. Service robotics was born because for a need of people with a living environment, we have, for example, you can see a robot for the garbage collector, or for different others' needs. For example, the robot can perform navigation in a dangerous environment, or environment which are not accessible by human beings. This is example of the UAV in the case of the what do we need in order to achieve and to deal with this new environment? Because now we are not anymore in a factory environment where everything is fixed. Now the robot needs the perception of the environment in order to deal with the changes of the world. It needs reactive behavior because the world is changing very fast. And it's also to share the experience with human beings, like in this example. So, we have seen that we use a robotics, the bird and bird to tell things and techniques for our control in the structure of the environment. And then we moved over the schedule to service robotics, where we have this new control method based on perception and action control. According to this, also the definition of robotics changing. In 1998, we had this definition of robotics, which was: a robot is a free programmable multifunctional manipulator designed to move material parts or specialized device to reliable programmable motion for performing the task. But 5 years ago, robotics, the definition of robotics changed, was robotics, the intelligent connection of perception to action. And then when we had Ronald Hartley defined robot as an intelligent robot is a machine able to extract information from its environment and use knowledge about its work to move simply in meaningful and pathless group matrix. You see that now robots are not anymore machine to the world, but becomes something which just interacts with the world and with humans. So we have the first problem now, because the robot concept of non-functioning environment, the robot was the perfect machine. They were robust, they worked perfectly, they were fast. But now what happens if we have to have and to plan robot behavior in order to deal with the changing environment? What was thinking was to merge artificial intelligence and robotics. What is the artificial intelligence? It's a research field which aims at understanding biological system and try to abstract the general principle from those and apply this principle to the design of useful artifacts. You see, artificial intelligence war is challenged between the chess champions against Glasgow, but real world is not chess playing. We are not this standard environment, and it becomes difficult. We should consider that. In order to build a system that is intelligent, it is necessary to have its representation ground in this model. This means that if you want to have something which is intelligent, it's not only the winner of the chess game, but something which can interact with the game. The current challenge in human robotics is starting here. It was 20 years ago, and we were this robot, and the challenge is that this robot can have a real football match against the winner of the football championship in 2002. Seems that we are a little bit far from that. And after looking at the results of the DARPA challenge, I think that everybody knows the DARPA challenge. It is a challenge that is organized by the DARPA, and in which, in this case, robots deal with the environment, and they have to drive a car for a billion, then they to enter the it's funny, but I think for people that work on that okay. The first paradigm developed in robotics related to this approach for the perception action loop was the hierarchy. We have here the three basic components, which are the actions, the cognition, and the perception. How does this work? The idea is quite simple. We are talking an agent which can act on the real world and feel the world through the sensor, and it can plan what how to plot a test based on the input time from the sensor. You see that this is very basic. It is what we expect if we think also our human works, which based on the sensory input can modify the action to do. But in this case, this make all this sequential because the flow of information is unprocessed by the central system before deciding the next action. So, together with this was developed another paradigm, which was the reactive paradigm, which is even simpler than the first one. There is no plan anymore, and the world is its own best model. This means that what we think is will be reflected in our action directly. What does this mean? This means that if we, for example, we have a sensor which is directly connected to our motors and is related, for example, to the light in the room and try to follow the light, we can define different, for example, behavior related to this and switch between this simple behavior in order to have a more complex. One of the first robot based on this was the other, and it was developed by the iRobot, and to be able to locate and detonate one within the safe zone. Here you see the different behavior which are related by a priority, which evolved as the highest priority. Another successful robot based on this pattern is the iRobot, developed by the room developed by a robot. I think some of you can have one of this room. And also for this robot you can have a different simple behavior, and it can manage the priority between this behavior to clean the room, and here you can see the example of the landing of the So, just to make a brief comparison between these two, we have this hierarchical model, which we have this sequential structure, and we need the model of the environment in order to deal with it. And then we have the reactive behavior, which has no care about the environment, but can work with asynchronous and parallel structure, and without using, as I said, models of the environment. Between these two, it was developed a new architecture, which was the hybrid architecture. It is quite simple. We have the reactive behavior we just saw. This plan, which basically defines a sample sequence corresponding to the active behavior. This means that it just defines okay, these are the goals, and in some ways it can activate or deactivate the behavior related to this. So, we have seen how the service robotics works, and we also see some successful example of service robotics using, for example, reactive value. And we are now can move toward bioaspiration and biomedics. Biomedics was used for the first time by the doctor which worked together with his wife on studying the natural biological processing in order to invent methods and machines that can in some way duplicate the solution. In particular, what he was trying to do with this artifact was to produce a physical device that can mimic the electrical action of the nerve. So we can say that the father of the biomedics is Dr. Hu. But what we learn from him? We try to understand why biology can be useful for robotics. In particular, we try to study biology, try inspiration from that in order to help new robot with new capabilities and increasing performance and whatever can be more effective in a real world. This does not mean that we are copying biology because it's not possible to do this, but this means that the goal is to extract the key principle. It's like to do a functional analysis of the biological model. And then what we would like to do is to translate them into a technological solution. So we can start from the biological system, as we say. We can study and modeling and try to implement it in a biomedic robot, which gives us a new application. But this biomedic robot can be also used for the investigation or validation of the models in order to see how much we are close to the model we have done here and how much is our knowledge of the biological system. This means that we could have new technology because we are but also new science, because in some way this is a validation of the biological model. So let's start again from the biological system. We do the engineering analysis, and we can, for example, develop a biomedical robot, because we, for example, study humans, and we can see how to deal with humans more. We, for example, develop this kind of robot. We can also develop a physical model of this, which can make us to build finally a large type of robot, which can bring us application, and also a biomedic robot, which can be used for validation. Notice, so we are not only the model now, but we have a platform which is used for validation of the robots. Let's say how the robotic science works. We study the phenomenon. In this case, for example, is to pick up something. We can do our hypothesis and model. And what we can study in this case are the human model, the work model, and the interaction between these. What was previously done in robotics was to try our model using, for example, animal. But what we propose to do using the one-inspired robotics is to have the robot instead of the animal in order to close this loop. So let's go back to our phenomenon with the hypothesis and the model. We can implement it in a robot platform, and we can perform an experiment which provides the validation. So, we have seen that it's important not only to implement, for example, the behavior, but it's important to have something which can interact with the world. And this is the message from Professor Ferrari. Example of biomedics robot, but for example, there are different examples. I'll choose two. One is this human robot at the Sant University. It has an anthropomorphic neurotic model here, because it is able to balance the motion using these two degrees of freedom which are in the waist. And Using this platform is possible, as you can see now, for example, to reproduce also model of disease or stroke, but also we are perfect working. I think that this one is one of the perfect working you can see in robotics, which is based on real contact of motion. You see, usually now I draw lots and from later you see not the work like this because of the center of this inside the polygon support. But this robot is able to throw this mechanism to compensate into real work like people. And in this way it's possible also to test, for example, working with the robot for a bit, which was in the job. Another wonderful example of biomimetics and biospatial robotics is the salamander. And this is the work done by the expert and colleagues. And this is the first robot, which can deal with transition from aquatic to terrestrial locomotion. This was the first part of my presentation. But now I will continue presenting now that we see what can be used to use biomimetics. Now we would like to understand how biomimetics and in particular neuroscience can be useful for robotics. Let's start from the perception action loop. Here we have the two different pathways, the effect pathway, which brings the signal from, in this case, the motor cortex to the final effector. This is how we change the work in the sensor when we and we will see the signal that comes to the sonar sensor. This is just the pathway which human use in order to deal with the real world. And it's not so simple like it could appear because human have a lot of sensors in their hand. And in particular, for what if we consider the sense of movement, this is an integration of a lot of sensors in which are coming inside our brain. And basically, in this case, has a basic role in this because this provides perception of the head movement and also the space, the position in the space. So, what is the vestibular system? The vestibular system is composed of two components: the semicircular camera, which detects the rotational movement, and the rotating probe, which can detect the linear acceleration. We have two vestibular systems here, close to our head. This information, if it's mixed together with the retinal information having with vision, this allows us to have a correct representation of the head position. Let's see how it is basic in two different reflexes. The first one is the vestibular ocular reflex. The vestibular ocular reflex is the reflex that you, for example, if you want to fix a point and you move the head, you see that the eyes moves in the opposite direction compared to the head. We did an implementation of this on the other robot. Yeah, you can see the robot. We had a model which was able to learn the dynamics of the robot. This was something that we have this first phase of learning, which in some way we can learn the dynamics of the eye. And then when our eye can converge, we can in some way compensate for the motion of the eyes even for dynamics which were faster or this is the work was seen by the robot in the last experiment since the animation of 0.4 minutes. It's also really basic in head stabilization. Human as well as animal use head stabilization because, as we said, we need to keep the head stable because the head is our reference frame in this case. You see that, for example, chicken, but also owl and pigeon other birds can stabilize the head even better than humans because they are able to compensate not only for rotation of the head, but also for translation. Humans cannot deal with translation, but do we see that humans is able to provide mechanism which in some way can compensate also for the translation? This is, for example, the rotation of head in the sagittal plane, and it is kept stable during the whole part. So let's see what happens in humans. We have seen that humans are not able to stabilize for the translation, but what we can do in order to deal with that is, for example, to rotate the head in order to compensate for the translation. This happens mainly for fast motion. Instead for slow motion, we mean slow motion and slow velocity of the subject, we hope that the head mainly compensates for the trunk rotation. So this means that we have two basic behaviors. The first one is to compensate for the rotation. I have for example here, what is under my head is moving and I move in the opposite direction in order to compensate. The other problem is that what is under my head is also doing this, is also translated. In order to compensate for this movement, I pitch down when the head goes up and I pitch up when the head goes down. And here you can see, for example, the stabilization of the head. This is the head in space. This is the trunk rotation. You can see that this is the rotation of the head with respect to the trunk, which is in anti-phase compared to the trunk motion. In order to study the head stabilization in human, you perform the experiment with a human subject, which we were asked to perform this complex locomotion task, which the subject had to avoid these obstacles, step forward and step home, and this and then go back. This experiment was done with two conditions for the gates. The first one was free gates. In this case, the subject was asked to look at wherever he or she wants. And for other gates, the subject in the second case was asked to look at one of these fixed points. The first one was going in this direction, and the second one was going in this other direction. We had 10 participants, we performed this using the pattern in motion action. We also had a tracker for the eye position, which was not used in this case for the stabilization, but we used it because in this experiment we also studied trajectory, as we will see later. And we used also effect mapping in order to allow the icon to perceive the position of the subject. And with three different ones. What we found out was that for the free gates condition, we had that the two signals were in phase, so there was no compensation in the head during the motion. But when we asked the subject to look at the fixed point, you can see that the head related to the trunk and the trunk are in anti-phase. So we completed this as using the cross correlation, so that we have a minimum Based on this principle, we try to extract a controller. As I said, we had these two problems. The first one was related to the compensation of the trunk, and the second problem was related to the compensation of the translation. In order to deal with the compensation of the translation, we see that if we were able to compensate for the trunk motion, we were also able to compensate for the translation, giving a suitable reference to our model. This first model that I have done in 2011 was a very simple model. It was based on an inverse Jacobian controller, which is able to provide the input to the velocity of the joint of the head, and then we have the sensory feedback was taken by an inertial sensor. These are the wrong picture of the head. This means that the model stabilizes along the three axis of motion. We implemented this model on with our colleagues from Waseda University in Tokyo on this robot. We performed an experiment. Here you can see, for example, what happens in case of stabilization is such a tough plane when we shape the experiment of the robot. You see that we move the what we consider the head, which is everything behind under the head, and the head can move in the opposite direction. We also performed a locomotion experiment in order to see what happens if we apply our stabilization algorithm, and you can see the difference between the if we activate our control, which is the red line, and we deactivate the control, which is the blue line, you see that the head is more stable in space. After this, we tried to make an adaptive controller, because that one was a really simple controller, and you see that we had some error on this, and we used a neural network and a feedback learning model. This model is able to estimate the rotation of the head, which allows the model to follow the reference orientation. This one. We compute the error here. The third model gives us the estimation of what pitch the movement of the head in the vector space, and this one is given to a neural network, which is able to extract the parameter for the joint. We also performed the same experiment on this. Here you can see again a really big perturbation, but which is the pitch rotation number, was able to reduce a lot compared to the perturbation. This is one for the pitch angle, and this one is for the robot. Also in this case we performed a locomotion task in which the robot was asked to work and reach the goal. Here you can see the results. We have this big peak due to the fact that the robot when it works has a big acceleration, and even if the model was able to learn the dynamics of the head, this turbulence here is too strong and therefore cannot be used. So, we have seen now how we could apply, for example, neuroscience, robotics in this case, which is mainly related to the perception action loop, and these two reflexes, with the vestibular ocular reflex and also the vestibular reflex of what we call head stabilization. But in order to deal with the real world, we will see that we need also anticipation and prediction, because otherwise we are always delayed compared to what happens in the real world. This is the theory of professor Giacosso, which define perception not just in the interpretation of sensory signal, but the prediction of the consequence of action. So, in a way, we can define perception as a single detection. This means that the perceptual activity is not just interpretation of the sensory information, but in a way it's in anticipation of the consequence of action. And in order to do this, I mean, to anticipate the consequence of action, we need an internal simulation of action. How we can do this internal this anticipation of the action? We have seen that this anticipatory mechanism can guide human behavior and allow us to perform more accurate movement. For example, if we consider this task to catch the ball, we have to anticipate the position of the ball, because if we do not do this and we move the arm only in the very last moment, due to the delay in our sensory feedback as well as in our motor action, we will not be able to catch the ball. The basis of human anticipation mechanism are what are called the neuroscience internal model, which are the model of the body in the world. They are usually classified into two groups: the formal models, which are the causal representation of the motor apparatus, and the inverse model, which instead is the inversion of the causal relation, and they deal with in some way the causal relation. So, you know, we've seen that the anticipation of the human is really basic in a lot of tasks. So, how we can bring this in robotics and what happens in robotics? Let's go back to our hierarchical architecture. You see that if we use this standard controller, we are not able to give the change to the model like the standard ones that in the example I'm touching on. But also reactive architecture do not allow us to solve this problem. So what we proposed was the unexpected perception system. This means that we could have an internal model that predicts the robot perception. In some way, it's like if we predict our sensory signal. So we have an internal representation of our world. You see the schema, this was the basic one, but here we have this expected perception generator, which is able of using the internal model of the body or of the world to generate a prediction. And in case this prediction is accurate enough, we do not go in the behavior plan again, but we can continue this loop, which is quite fast, because we can generate in a feed forward way, we can generate the action based on our prediction, and we do not need to plan each time the next action to perform. This allows to be fast enough and to control the robot in order to deal with different tasks that we are going to show. An example is this one, which is the prediction of other agent action based on this bio. You see that the architecture can be applied, for example, to the reconstruction of the environment. What does this mean? Usually, the reconstruction of the environment is a task which requires a lot of computational power as well as too much time to deal with the real-time task. So, what we propose is to insert this architecture and use this prediction generated by our internal model in order to close the loop here when it's possible without compute each time the computation of the This was the scheme we proposed. It is based on the visual processing, which is about to compute the data construction of the program. This is the other pressure program, which generates a trajectory for a parallel for working on, for example. And here we have the low-level controller, which sends commands to the model. What we added was this internal model and this other model, which are the nodes, the APT generator and the visual controller. In particular, as I said, this is the classical part loop in which we have planning, execution, and then again sense. Planning here, using the visual processing, we generate a trajectory and we can act on the board. And then again, we will receive the input from the sensor. What we added was this internal model, which is able to predict what will be my motion. This means that if I learn how the image changes according to my movement, I can predict what will happen here, and I can generate a new image, which is synthetic, which is a 3D image, which allows me to be very fast and will not need a new computation of the previous thing. So, how can I do this? For example, we implemented this here in this system, which is which was basically composed of the head of our robot, and we had the head input on all the encoders together with the camera. What happens is this. We, in some way, using a neural network, we were able to make a link between the motion of the head together with the change in the image. So this means that if I move or I turn the head in a direction, I know what I can expect in my 3D scene, how my image can change. So, in this case, I can generate a prediction of what will be in the world and a prediction of what I will see turning the head. So, I have, for example, these two images. This is my predicted image, and this is the head, because I can predict my movement, but the head is moving toward the robot, so what is different between what I predicted was this one, the red part, because this is not dependent on my motion, but on the motion of the head. Another example of prediction of the agent is, for example, the smoothness of the movement. In particular, we have seen in the previous example that using this architecture, we can in some way predict the sensory input based and using the internal model, just learning what how the sensor input will change if I move my body. So, but in this case, we apply the same concept to the external world. In this case, we want to learn how the world will change. In this case, we want to learn what is the motion of the body through time. Not only how the world changes when I interact with the world, but also how some dynamics of the board changes during, for example, this teaching task. The first example is the smooth pursuit element. I think that more or less you know knows what is this mutual circular movement. It is an element which is generated in case of the moving objects. It is one of the slowest movements of our eyes and allows the subject to follow and move on. In order to the real objective of the smooth circular movement is to completely align the velocity of the eye together with the velocity of the target. This means that if we are able to align this two velocity, we can keep the target fixed on the eye. In order to do this, we need to generate a prediction of the motion of the target, because you know, we have a delay in the sensory signal which does not allow to do this task with any equipment. What we proposed in 2010 was this model of smooth pursuit, which was based on the first model of Shivat and Shah. We use a retro neural network here, which is basically the opposite square algorithm, in order to in some way predict the to predict the dynamics of the target. We use an inverse dynamics controller, which in some way is able to give commands and in order to allow the model to follow, to allow the eye to follow the input coming from the predictor. And then we have another block in which we put all the known motion of the target. This means that if we see, let's say, a pendulum, we can learn that dynamics, and we store this dynamics, and we can use it for if we, for example, we are again in a task in which we perform this kind of motion. The algorithm, as I said, was based on the recursive square, in which we have these two parameters, W, which are using the regression method, this allows us to compute the prediction based on the current state of the target, which is this. An example of the implementation is this one. We have the robot that can follow the moving target. It's, you can see that the robot is able to predict because when I stop, the ball with my hand, the eyes continues moving in that direction because they were predicting that the target would be moving. Here we can see the results of the experiment in which we forced. After 0.8 seconds, we recognize what is the dynamics of the target and we can completely align the target and the dynamics. Using this model, we also performed the tracking across occlusion. In humans, tracking across occlusion is not made with continuous smooth pursuit, but it is a combination of the smooth pursuit and saccade. This smooth pursuit is activated while the sound the target remains visible, and then we elicit a saccade to predict the point where the object will appear. We, based on our previous model, we have the saccade generator, which if an occlusion is detected, is able to find the edge of the occluder and then generate a saccade at the right time based on the estimation down in the inside of the predictor and the internal domain. So in case of the saccade, this is our path. We do not use to know the smooth pursuit model, but we assess it using the saccade generator and the best dynamics controller to drive the eye toward the position. This is an example. You see that the robot generates a pin which are this fast movement when the target is active. And this is dynamics, this is, for example, the position. We have the target in the stable, and then we have the height being fixed here when there is a occlusion. And then, only when this estimate is the appearance of the target, this is the circuit, which corresponds to this fast movement in the rest. We also performed, based on this more complex task, always based on prediction of movement or the edges. In this case, we used the arm, the particular, we had this robot, and we had always this pendulum motion, and the robot was asked to punch the target. This means that compared to the previous project, we have a complete different dynamics. Here, because you see that the length of the height is very simple compared to the one of the. Here is just description of the target. The robot has to anticipate the process position X on this axis, on Z, on this and has to punch the target if we arrive at the right position. Here we have an example of this. Robot following the target using the head, and when the target is in its aim, can punch it in the head. I think we can stop here and then
continue. Yeah, let's thank the speaker for his presentation.